should Ronda Rousey shut down the Cyborg or crush Gina Carano? Can Lyoto Machida get revenge for Anderson Silva's leg? And how much tough can a tough buff watch while a tough buff can't watch tough? That and more ridiculous tongue twisters. This is MMA on Draft. Welcome to MMA on Draft from First Run TV, filmed at Petey's Place in Tarzana, California. I'm Rich Slayton, joined as always by Joe Cervellin, Gary T, and Donna Gonzalez. And our guest this time of Nuwaza Apparel and Brewaza Beer, Travis Nuwaza. Thank you very much for joining us, sir.
Thank you for having me.
Let's get off to the races. Ronda Rousey has two potential title challengers on the line, Christina Cyborg Santos or Gina Carano, one of my personal crushes. Who do you guys want to see her fight? Do you guys want to see her fight the beauty of women's mixed martial arts, the originator and the person who put the sport on the map for women, or do you want to see her fight against a demon beast who's made primarily of muscles and hatred?
Oh, we're going to have to see Cyborg first.
Yeah. Cyborg
easily,
first.
Cyborg. Easily. We can't not see Cyborg first. I mean, there's so much hype. If we got to cash in now. And Carano hasn't been in the picture for a long time. I'd rather see Kathy Long versus Ronda Rousey than anyone else.
I agree. Unless Gina's been doing some kind of secret ninja training while she's also been filming movies that we don't know about for the last 5 years. And like, it's not a fight. I'm a Gina fan also, but it's not a fight. And Cyborg's it. That's what we want to see.
Does anybody care about any other storylines in female MMA outside of Carano, Cyborg, or Rousey? I mean,
Holly Holm.
Yeah, I think there's some exciting female fighters.
I mean, Misha Tate beat Carmouche. Now what? I mean, it's almost like,
well, that was
Misha
controversial.
And
that
would
was
be good.
Controversial.
If Carano comes back against Misha Tate, that would be a
ooh.
Good fight.
Ooh,
yeah.
I'd watch that.
Or against Carmouche.
I think Rousey should go for Carano first.
Carano needs a warm-up.
I know. Let me tell you the reason why. Because,
or, you know, a respectful warm-up.
Carano is a kickboxing fighter, and she's pretty damn good at stand-up.
Rousey, she was good when she was training.
She gets some.
She went toe-to-toe with Cyborg. She was outboxing Cyborg.
I think it would be really good to gauge Rousey's skills standing up with Carano before going to Cyborg. Because if she can't stand with Carano at all, she will get destroyed by Cyborg.
Hmm. We all love Gina. She was the pioneer of the sport. She's gorgeous. She was a great role model. But
Gary always hits on Gina.
Is Gina really the fighter that you're making her out to be? I don't think, maybe back in her prime, that would have been a great analogy.
She's still got a stand-up. I don't think she lost a stand-up.
But if she hasn't been training every single day, and that ring rust is a real thing.
I think she still trains to some level, but it might not be, you know, competitive level.
Sure.
But apparently she walks lighter than she used to, so I don't know.
Oh, I would imagine, yeah.
You know, but you would think it would be harder for her as she gets older to be lighter for most fighters, but to me that indicates maybe she has a better diet now or with whatever the sports science is.
I think that maybe a director wanting her to get skinny, get some more
so
roles.
But she wasn't able to do that as a pro fighter. She
right,
barely
because
made
you
145.
Have to keep that muscle on.
Yeah, so if she's walking around lighter now, maybe there's something new in her equation.
But at same time, you got to remember, she's never gone against somebody of Rousey's caliber.
And Rousey
right.
is
very
top
true.
Possibly
class
Cyborg.
Right now.
Yeah. And that's the fight people want to see. Don't get me wrong, I'll buy into the media machine. Like, I'll watch either.
Yeah.
But honestly.
But Cyborg the fight that you want to see?
Aesthetically, I want to see Carano.
Of course. Aside from the aesthetics.
Well, what's a better
Cyborg
looking fight?
The fight that you want to see more.
Absolutely.
This is what I'm saying.
Is Dennis Hallman, Brian Ebersole a hotter fight than Carano?
It depends
Ronda
on
Rousey.
What Ebersole has
exactly.
shaved into
exactly.
his chest.
No, but Rousey's chasing, she's bad-mouthing Cyborg and praising Carano. Because
No, she's not. What are you talking about?
She's saying how great Carano is.
Yeah, she shouts out Carano.
Rather than the fight.
But
she's almost like
Ronda's
she wants
thing. She's the bad guy.
Then go fight the person that you know. She's afraid of Cyborg. She doesn't want to fight Cyborg.
How about Carano versus Cyborg 2?
Like the movie.
As a title eliminator fight? That actually has legs.
Isn't Dan Damon
Dana?
Because Dana. Rousey is set up right now to fight Alexis Davis coming up this summer.
I think I should be a booker for women's MMA. I'm pretty good at making these matches.
There you go.
Invicta, Joe Cervellin. You can get him on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, possibly Vine, but who uses Vine anymore, really? Let's be honest.
Is that done already? Vine is done?
I think it's huge in the UK right now. I just heard.
Final question. If you have Rousey versus Cyborg versus Carano in an American Gladiators challenge, who comes out on top?
Cyborg.
America.
Jiu-Jitsu.
Well, speaking of how America comes out, are we being inundated with too much of the Ultimate Fighter? Yes, it's fun to have more fights. It's fun to see the background. Is the product getting stale? Especially after we just had the Canadians versus the Australians, which was oddly surprisingly the most boring group of people who've ever been on television. And then
but
you
polite.
Also have but very polite. And then you have the tough Brazil that no one's watching because you have to pay $8.99 for it.
Right.
And then you have right now BJ Penn and Frankie Edward with BJ Penn trying to make a soundbite every 7 seconds.
Right.
Is there too much Ultimate Fighter right now?
Wait, show of hands.
BJ's going to kick Frankie Edgar's ass.
Did anybody watch Canada, Australia?
I watched most of it.
Okay. Did anybody watch Brazil? Did anybody watch China?
BJ Penn.
The
that's
USA
my answer.
One is the There's only the one China we're watching. One. Exactly. You didn't even know.
Yeah. Well,
the USA one is the only one that anybody's watching.
To be honest with you guys, I haven't watched anything past season 10. I've seen every episode of every season until 10. My friend Tony Ferguson's a great friend of mine. I didn't even know that he won. Like what? I was like, what season? I was like, Brock, and I was like, Carmen. I was like, oh, I remember the commercial.
Yeah, and they're on Good. 19 now.
Let me tell you about my thoughts about Tough. You guys remember Tough started out as the winner is the next great contender for the championship belt in the UFC. That's how the premise was pitched to us. Is I believe that, and they were very successful
right.
in a very small level with Evans, Matt Serra, even Forrest Griffin.
Then Ben Forrest Griffin?
I'm going to say because
he won. Forrest
Griffin. Well, I mean, he won.
Griffin Bonner. Come on now.
He won the title. Then we have sort of the second tier fighters who won Tough, like Sanchez, Bisping, Roy Nelson.
Diego Sanchez is a second tier fighter?
I think he's a great fighter, but he's always one fight away. He's not the guy that holds the belt.
He's the one fight.
You know, then there's third level fighters. To me, like Mac Danzig,
like
Amir Sadola. You know, guys who won the Tough, but they're never really accomplished, even being as a winner. So yes, it's getting stale. It's getting boring. So unless next year's Tough is Tough Midgets,
well, it's
I'm not going to watch.
It's 115-pound ladies.
Yeah, I'll watch that.
Right.
But you also got to remember this. I mean, any fighter could beat any other fighter at that caliber. And that's what we need to take into account. I mean, the show's entertaining. Like, the fighters are at that caliber, but at the same time, you see some fighters where you're like, oh, well, you know, like, they're very, you know, one-dimensional. And I think that it's definitely a proving ground for a lot of things.
Absolutely.
But like, there's a lot of great fighters coming out, even if they're, you know, quote-unquote second tier. I mean, because, like, Roy Nelson can knock out anyone in the heavyweight roster on any day.
Right.
But for entertainment, it's like, look at how good the fighters are, entertainment value of the product
itself. Nobody watches any
of
the other one except for the original. So it kind of doesn't matter that they have, you know,
it's boring.
Portugal, it's an international market.
They're spanning internationally.
That's great for the fans there. I hope they're watching it, but none of us are watching.
Well, here's the question. With Tough, yes, I enjoy watching the fights. The fights, a fight's a fight's a fight.
Totally.
But is the actual product, is the 45 minutes of television in an hour, are we seeing the exact same thing as the new cast every time?
Well, it's sports entertainment. I mean, if you watch WWF, not WWE, don't sue me. It's the same thing week after week. So why should we expect anything different?
Right.
And plus, these are real people. Like, and sometimes they have to portray characters because, you know, it is television.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, like, you're a fan of the sport, not necessarily the entertainment.
Yeah,
entertainment's not for you guys. It's for people at home.
Also remember that shows like Survivor eventually wore out. American Idol, after 10 years, ratings are low. So you expect this to happen. It's just, well, what should they do with the brand? Should they just keep going, or just take a break?
It also gets people interested in the sport. You know, people who don't know about MMA, it's a good transition for some people. They maybe want to get into the personalities of it.
They can become fans of the actual fighter. Like, if I watch the show, then I can follow a fighter. Perfect example, people who watch the mixed show with both the men and the women, I watched it. And I happen to like Juliana Pena after watching her, and a lot of people were like, oh, I hated her.
Juliana.
And I found it really interesting because I'm like, it created either a fan base of hating her or
Juliana
a fan base of liking
versus
her.
Carano when she's back next year. She's coming off an injury.
Yeah.
Invicta,
I thought it was interesting that it created a character for her that all we would have known about her is her fighting and without Tough.
Right.
It does create characters. Many characters there are. Some of them, a lot of us can't see without paying. Was it now $8.99 or $9.99?
$9.99.
I still haven't seen the Vanderlei Chael Sonnen melee because it's not. I don't have UFC Fight Pass, and I try not to illegally stream things because I'm trying to be a gentleman. Is Fight Pass actually serving the fans, or is it just a cash grab?
Well, Dana White was saying that it was free for the first month or so, and there's more subscribers. There are more subscribers now that it's $9.99 a month than when it was free. So it might be some reverse.
It's not a lot of money, but I mean, it's like really, we pay for the pay-per-views. We watch Tough. We watch the prelims.
But he's not hard selling. Dana's thing, he pretty much shrugs, and he's like, well, don't buy it then. You don't have to. If you have enough fights to watch, that's great. If they're, you know, and it's also geared more for international fans.
That makes sense.
A lot of it's free TV there. Like, I believe some upcoming fights in England, that's free on one of their local TV channels, but it's not free here because of, you know, the business of TV. Fox can only put on so many fights with their budget.
I'm not a fan of
when it comes
UFC
to,
on Fox.
When it, comes to when it comes to content, just period content, let's say Netflix, you pay, what, $10, $9 for a lot of content, a lot of different genres.
And that's the model for the future anyway.
Correct. With a UFC pass, I went to their website and I tried it's $9.99, and they break it into sections, live events, TV shows, originals, UFC, and the fight library, which is, that's to me, the fight library, that's the huge asset that
they
have.
And it's supposed to be everything, or at some point?
I'm not sure if it's everything, but I mean, I'm assuming it's a lot of fights from Pride and all that stuff.
Right, right.
And live events, can we get the live events? The TV shows, I mean, tough is stale, you know, and all the highlight shows that they have around, so I think that's also stale. And the originals, I mean, originals is more like...
The highlight shows are stale?
I mean, I watch
originals on CW every Thursday night.
Originals are like featurettes and interviews.
Gary has a very high standard for his.
I do. Highlights, they are by definition the most exciting part of the fight.
I think highlights are boring because they're out of context.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So seeing the craziest knockout ever, it's like it's out of context.
Absolutely. Todd, Mike Russo versus Todd Duffy. I mean, like that whole fight isn't a highlight. It's the last 20 seconds. Yeah. But at the same time, I mean, you. It's a great deal. You guys are clowns if you don't think so. I mean, you get access to all the Affliction cards, Strikeforce, WEC, you get Primetime, Countdown, and I don't know about you guys, but like, I'm a loser. Like, I love that stuff. I absolutely love that stuff. I can't get enough. As a consumer, I'm glad, Dana, that you are finding a way to get it to me without going through any other cable or satellite company. I love you for it, and thank you.
Well, there is your answer.
$1.
That's why it exists. So one in five really wants the Fight Pass.
There you go.
For my liking, there's not enough content, original content to pay the $9.99.
What if you were a new fan?
Do you want them to come up with new content on top of that? I mean, isn't the fact that it's an archive is what Travis says that he really likes about it, but you want new content on top of all the other new content?
Let me what I thought. To check this out. Check out this pitch. If somehow someone was able to create a fight network where you could watch any league of any mixed martial arts anywhere in the world, so you can turn genre, I want Krav Maga, a tournament in Israel, Abu Dhabi, UFC, Pride, having the ability to watch every single fight in martial arts around the world.
What about the 5-on-5 fighting they're doing now?
Maybe. Oh my gosh, that was so bad.
Having the ability to show that kind of content, for that I'd pay $20 for that amount.
I would pay $20 a month just to watch all the X-Arms, but that's just me. I mean... There's so much. I mean, you can't be greedy. Content. You're saying like, oh
awesome.
Man,
everything,
like
everything.
You're doing the most well done, well put together fight, the best fighters in the world at the highest production. But I want to see this too.
I want to.
But
see
that would be awesome.
I want to see
would
be
awesome. Well, it would be awesome if you could fly too. But then
they fight.
Netflix shows us a lot of different stuff, genres, you know, a lot of stuff. That's what I want to see. That's what I'm used to right now.
I think the argument Gary's making here is that it's a lot of money for very little stuff that we haven't already seen.
But what about new fans?
I think that's a fair
argument. 12-year-old boy or girl.
You're paying for the archive. That's the
for new fans,
concept.
I'm not a new fan, though.
What about someone?
Well, then
you know,
make sure no one has highlights on YouTube then.
What about it, someone who is, you know, coming of age now, guy or girl, and they're just finding out about MMA?
They can watch the library on YouTube. I mean, any other, they can watch.
Not all the stuff.
Yeah, but at I pay for quality. Like, I'll wait 10 minutes for my video on YouTube to load up the
quality.
10. I'll pay more. I go to the nice movie theater. I don't want to go to that
But a 12-year-old kid who expect their mom and dad to pay to see a couple of guys beat the hell out of each other. I don't think mom and dad
would go for it. Maybe they're mowing lawns so they can watch the archive themselves.
Exactly.
That's the American dream. Mow lawns, and then you pay $9.
Dana, here's my 10 bucks, man. I want to give me some fighting. Give me some blood. Give me the octagon.
We might as well start exploiting the youth now.
That's actually why my family came here from Poland. Because they were like, I want to be able to mow lawns so that I can watch on-demand fights.
There you go.
So perhaps we can save the economy. I've been turned.
Perhaps this nation's economy won't implode if we just have Fight Pass and... I think we could save the country with it.
I don't think.
You know why I don't have? I'm not gonna lie. You know why I don't have Fight Pass? Because I have a smart TV and I don't have a connection between my computer and the smart TV. But if I could stream Fight Pass next to my Netflix that's already on my TV and I didn't have to do any kind of work other than hit a button, then I would do it.
Google Chrome.
A few years
ago, plug it into your USB drive. Bam.
A few
bucks.
Years ago, I couldn't get enough MMA. Like 4 years ago, I could not get enough MMA. Bellator, anything. The ones with the crappy lighting, I could not get enough MMA. And I was sparring boxing all the time, so I came home all beat up, and all I wanted to do was watch fights.
More
and just
fights.
Like, yeah. But now there are enough fights, even just from UFC, let alone Bellator and everywhere else.
Hey, King of the Cage is on TV.
Yeah, I can't even keep up with it. So that's
what? King of the Cage?
I think it's a wonderful problem.
Just watch fights.
I think maybe what it is, we're all used to knowing everything about every single fighter. Because when we started watching it, we were like experts by default of just watching all there was, but now it's a bigger sport.
It's so diffused, it's hard to have that knowledge base.
You also get the whole Pride catalog.
Right.
You gotta remember that. No commercials, you don't have to watch Spike.
Yeah. Are you sponsoring them? Like are you officially sponsoring them?
Not yet.
Okay.
UFC guys, Bruaza and Nuwaza Apparel, both would be fantastic sponsors. Just a little ticker there on the bottom on that UFC Fight Pass.
Maybe you could superimpose Nuwaza Apparel onto Fat BJ Penn's Fight Pass.
BJ versus Machida size?
Well, yeah. And
walking
you
out
get to
Wallace Barkley.
Yeah. Wait, did they have that? Was that K1?
No, that's
no,
right.
That was, he, no, they
no, that
didn't.
That was
a Rumble in the Bronx.
Have you seen the video of that?
No. That was in Hawaii. That was like Rumble on the Rock.
It's shot with a handy cam in like a closet somewhere.
You know, honestly, Scott Nelson, I think you did that. So I will call you later. But yeah. Good job.
Well, one place you might want to get your sponsorships in is in the new 1FC with their new vice president, Rich Ace Franklin. By the way, Rich, thank you for letting me shake your hand at the airport the other day. It was very nice of you, even though it was 8 in the morning. You were a gentleman and a scholar, sir. Rich Franklin now.
What did you do with your hand after that?
He kissed it.
I just held it. It was like this.
He went
hello.
Like this.
Hi.
He rode his whole plane flight like this.
Yeah, I was like, it's a champion now. This is great.
Was that why you had ringworm on your
face? Yeah, I know. It was really bad.
Staph infection and all that.
You do what you gotta do for the sport, you know? Yeah. You love it.
You got a black eye.
So, Rich, moving from fighter now into vice president, a pretty nice transition. What do you think, do you have any idea of how he'll fare? Do you see him as being one of the guys who makes that transition well?
And, I do.
Yeah?
Do you not? I do.
I think Rich is absolutely capable.
Yes.
One thing we all forgot. He's now enemy number one of Mr. Uncle Dana.
Mm.
No, he's actually still contracted as a fighter through UFC. Dana gave him his blessing.
He did, yeah.
Well, I mean, those Zions commercials had to, give some weight for him to make that argument.
Sure, I think it's great because Dana, everybody acknowledges, none of these guys are going to catch up. None of these other promotions are going to catch up to the UFC. They're going to be feeders into the UFC, and that's what they exist for, and I think it's awesome. So to actually have a good relationship with your new vice president, I think it's very smart on the UFC's.
I like that.
Well, off the record, Rich is going to have to cut off a horse head and leave it in.
Yeah.
The bed of,
I think it's great. He's been a fighter. He's going to know how to treat fighters.
Awesome.
I don't think that there's a downside to this. And if he can still fight for the UFC, I mean, who knows? I'm just saying that it's pretty awesome.
If you were in Rich's position, what would your goals be with something like 1FC? What would you want to do with a company of that size?
To do exactly what I just said, to turn it into a feeder for the UFC. Absolutely.
Number two would be avoiding assassination from the Yakuza.
Yeah. True.
Number one, watch out. You know where you're at, Rich.
Well, isn't number one avoiding Staph? But then... all the other things.
Number three, shaking my hand at the airport.
He went home and he said, you know who I met today?
Yeah.
Rich Slayton.
Yeah, this guy's a great, great fellow.
What did he do with his hand after he shook yours?
He licked it. It was really weird. I didn't see that coming.
With that whole soccer kicking rule? Rich, you need to be on top of that. Mm. Let him just soccer kick. Whatever. Like, come on, man.
I'm a point to the back of the head. Straight down.
Whatever. It's Asia. No one
cares. Maybe he should.
Like, you're not playing your cards right if you're fighting there.
Fight to the death.
Yeah.
Be a weapon, like Schwarzenegger's movie. What is that? The Running Man.
Yeah.
A chainsaw hanging somewhere in the little Thunderdome.
Should Rich Franklin have one FC, have one fight on every card that is that five-on-fight Russia style?
With barbed wire, I want it to be like WCW Ric Flair 1989.
Did you guys watch that trash, by the way, the five-on-five fight? You watched it.
I saw one. I think it was Polish guys versus Russians or something.
Yep, that's what I saw.
Was that on World Star?
It should have been. At minimum. It should have been.
Tell the audience what it was, because
it's 5-on-5 mixed martial arts, and it's just as awful as it sounds.
But it's not even real MMA; it's more like a brawl.
Yeah,
because they can gang up on more than one person.
Oh, so it's soccer hooligans.
Yes,
basically. So once one or two guys is defeated, they just gang up. You know,
it's ridiculous.
It might be interesting if you can only do 1-on-1. But something bad's gonna happen, because you know you could hit someone from behind. You're getting punched from all directions.
Don't pull guard.
Oh, you just can get stomped on. Yeah.
Are those legal, though? Can you stomp?
It's Russia. Everything's legal.
Love it.
I think the idea is interesting. If there were certain rules in place, maybe it could be a sport.
Well, that was the IFL. Wasn't that the IFL?
No. IFL had one person, had two people.
Oh, yeah, it was a team concept.
No, it was a tag? You had a tag?
No. It was just five guys in a room.
Watching that. Yeah. I would watch tag team, but you have to tag. Straight, like, yeah.
I like
that. That might be interesting. Like a dominating position and then tag? Or, like, how would that work?
You know that, Rich Franklin, you're going to have to figure that one out, too. That's just another... thing you gotta think about. But does that mean Alex Emelianenko? Does that mean he comes back if it's if they're doing these talks? Because I know no one's like.
Well, he could do it like Old Dirty Bastard style, and while he's on the run, he could stop by, fight real quick, and then evade the police.
Okay.
And be on the
run. If we're having tag team MMA, who is your number one pick for your favorite tag team in mixed martial arts?
Oh.
It's gotta be within weight class, though.
Oh,
okay.
So
the Diaz brothers.
Yeah. The Diaz brothers.
Silva,
okay. Yeah. Totally.
Wait, you get to
Silva
pick weight
and Machida.
Class?
Silva and Machida
as a tag team.
Silva's looking good. Yeah, did you put up new footage of him boxing the other day?
We're talking like
Silva Machida as a tag team.
What are the rules set? What can you do?
I mean, you can't both be in the cage at the same time.
Right. Okay.
Oh, can we get Cyborg and Rousey on as a tag team?
Cyborg's gonna be heavy.
We could do anything.
Yeah.
How about GSP and Anthony Pettis or Jose Aldo on the same team?
Not the same weight class.
I'd take Pettis. I'd make Pettis Aldo. That'd be a good tag team.
Yeah.
I'd take that one for sure. Or you might kind of want to switch it up, do something so that you have two different skill sets taken care of.
Sure.
Right.
So you might want to do something like a Matt Hughes if we're gonna resurrect somebody.
Yeah. Sure.
Like you do Matt Hughes and then later stage Josh Koscheck. So you have one guy for the wrestling and then one guy for the hands.
How about a mix?
Who has the
mix
out of them?
I was wondering that myself. I'm like,
Paul Daly.
How about female male mixed tag teams?
Cormier and Cyborg.
I don't know. Who wins that fight anyway?
Well, it depends who they're going against.
I'd pick, I'm going to go with, I'm going to go with Bigfoot Silva.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because big dudes, right?
Right.
And Mighty Mouse.
And Giant Silva. I'm going to cap both of them. Oh, wait, do I get to pick the two? Or am I fighting?
You're picking the tag team.
Yeah, Giant Silva and Bigfoot Silva. Silva All Brothers, right. Let's do
oh,
it.
Oh, that's a pretty good one.
What about Hawk and Animal, man?
Road Warriors
and the Bushwhackers.
Chuck and Rashad.
Chuck and Rashad. That's a very interesting combination.
Hey, now I have to reevaluate mine. Okay.
Rashad, the guy who sent Chuck kind of on his way.
One fight that's not going to be tag team is going to be the new middleweight championship fight between Chris Weidman and Lyoto the Dragon Machida.
Who?
Oh my gosh! Oh. Everything about
that guy you fought, Baby J.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that guy.
Gonna be good.
Yeah, he jumps around a little bit. Kiss people in the face.
He kisses them on the face?
Kicks.
That's unlike
it. I do mumble sometimes. Sorry. I didn't do my, that whole Peter Piper stuff.
This is gonna be a match. This is gonna be, this might be a whoever messes up first match.
Mm.
If you don't think that these guys are at the highest caliber.
Right.
Oh, man. I mean, I think the one thing that probably, I mean, obviously, Weidman taking down Machida. Can it happen? Machida's so excellent at defending takedowns off the cage and off the cage. I mean, he's so hard to take down. Yeah. But then again, I mean, this is Chris Weidman.
It is, but nobody can confuse opponents like Lyoto Machida and his crazy unorthodox style. How many times have we seen in the middle of the fight, like somebody's face just be like,
yeah, but have we ever seen Weidman confused?
No, but we haven't been paying attention to Weidman for that long.
I've rewatched some of his fights.
Some of them, but what I'm saying is, go back through. Machida has a history of of just confusing the crap out of his opponents.
And almost getting triangled by Tito Ortiz. That's so true. That needs to be talked about too. I mean, Chris Weidman went to ADCC and crushed everybody.
That's true.
So it's not like he's just like.
But it's not like Machida's a white belt or something on the ground.
Before Silva 2, and not because of the leg break, I gained a lot of respect for Weidman in the second Silva fight. Absolutely. I thought he got lucky the first time Silva or Weidman won.
He was winning the fight.
Well, I think, I think Silva was coming back, but he clamped, we talked about
a lot of people win rounds against Silva.
But Weidman 2, before the shin catastrophe, I saw something in Weidman when I said, holy crap, this guy really
is
good.
That's legit. Totally.
So I think he's not as fancy a fighter as Machida, or his style's not as overt.
Sure.
But he's just, like I said about Aldo, he has good eyes. Yeah. He's just watching. He's scanning. He doesn't flinch.
Sure.
Just like it's hard to hit him.
Sure.
And his, if anyone could do it, it's Machida. But what Machida did to Bader, I don't think he's going to be able to pull that off with Weidman. I think Weidman is going to carefully overwhelm him. He's so aggressive.
Have we ever seen?
But not foolish.
Machida overwhelmed? I guess we have.
Not really overwhelmed. You could say
John
that
Jones, when he got a hold of him.
Maybe Shogun in round two.
That's who I was.
That's like a fight.
I'm gonna go with Machida on this one. I know because I went.
Well, you're wrong, Gary.
I went with Weidman against Silva. I'm gonna pick Machida for the simple reason is that I always felt sorry for Machida that his era ended kind of early. Remember 5, 6, 7 years ago when Joe Rogan proclaimed this is the new Machida era, which people thought would last in the next 10 years.
Yeah.
He was that damn good. And I always felt bad that he didn't achieve that status of being a long-standing champion. And I think this has been a long road back. And I want him to get this one. I really want Machida to win. And I think he's got the skill set, the speed, and what you guys mentioned, the basicness to pull this off. I really do.
Same logic. I really think that this year's next NFL champions will be the Buffalo Bills because I feel so bad for all the Super Bowls they lost back in the 90s. So
yeah. That's a good idea, but I mean, I think that we all gotta learn to not ever, bet against Weidman. Mm. I mean, I think he's earned that. And then absolutely. I want karate to win too, man.
Yeah.
Like if anyone wants it to win, like I want it to win.
Ralph Macho be nice.
Dude, don't
cheering man.
Cheetah's
but, but you gotta remember, like, I mean, trying to be a long running champion right now
in hard.
The fastest growing sport with the most crazy animal super freak athletes like this is
Yoel,
you're not gonna see
easily
right
now.
You're not gonna see a lot of people easily. Defending their title once or twice a year. I mean, there's just animals who are hungry. I mean, it's literally finding out who's the toughest man.
Yeah,
like there's no one who's gonna reign. I mean, the longest reign we saw was Fedor, and it'll never be seen again. And I hope it does, but it ain't gonna.
Should
happen.
We wager a bet so that the first show we do? When the fight's done, the losers have to do something on air. Illegal,
but
permanently scarring, but
just show with no shirt on, maybe. Well,
what? Hello, no.
Maybe people can write. Maybe fans can send suggestions to the email.
About
what the losers on this Machida Weidman bet will have.
If
to
you
do
have any suggestions for a bet on Machida Weidman, or you have questions for us, you can email us at.
MMA on draft@pegsidefilms.com.
So let's take our poll right now. We have one for Machida.
Two for Machida.
Three for Machida. I'm saying round two or round three. Win for Machida.
I'm American, so Weidman.
Okay.
Weidman.
All right.
So you have to come back, Travis.
So send us some suggestions for what the bet might
be.
And we'll discuss that and figure out what our terms are going to be put out.
No broken glass.
No,
I'm not going to swallow broken glass.
Let's get your guys' belly buttons pierced.
Yeah.
I've been wanting that for a long time. Is that a loss or a win?
That would be good for the company.
Yeah, exactly.
You're Prince Albert from the WWE.
I already have one.
You got one?
For First Run TV from Petey's Place in Tarzana, California, this has been MMA on Draft. I'm Rich Slayton, joined.
Gary Teperman.
Donna Gonzalez.
Joseph Allen.
And Travis Nuwaza of Nuwaza Apparel and Brewaza. Drink that stuff. We may not be professional fighters, but we do have cameras on us, and we are Monday Morning Corner Men. See you next time.